Please see the PDF that accompanies this program for additional materials.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Longest Race. Inside the secret world of abuse, doping, and deception on Nike's elite running team. By Kara Goucher with Mary Pallon. Read by Kara Goucher with an introduction read by Mary Pallon.
This book is dedicated to the believers and those who find power in writing their own stories. When a woman tells the truth, she is creating the possibility for more truth around her. Adrienne Rich.
Introduction. When Kara Goucher reached out to me in November 2019 to ask if I would consider helping her tell her story, I thought the request would be easy to shrug off. I had long known Kara's name, having covered running as a journalist on the New York Times sports desk from 2011 to 2014, then having written about sports for The New Yorker, Esquire, and Vice, among other publications. I knew that she was one of the grittiest American distance runners of the 21st century, a podium finisher on the track at the World Championships and the New York City and Boston marathons. I knew that she had made her second Olympic team in 2012, barely a year after giving birth to her son, a relatively novel occurrence at the time. I also knew that in recent years, she'd become something of a pariah. In 2015, she and her fellow Olympian husband, Adam Goucher, had publicly accused their former coach, running icon Alberto Salazar, of pushing the limits of anti-doping rules. Kara and Adam had been coached by Alberto at the Nike Oregon Project, an elite, secretive, lavishly funded team based out of the headquarters of the world's largest athletics apparel brand. In September 2019, just 2 months before Kara reached out to me, Alberto received a 4-year ban from coaching from the U.S. Anti-Doping Agency. Kara, who had provided evidence in the case, wasn't implicated in any wrongdoing, though neither were her teammates Galen Rupp and Mo Farah. Word of the Salazar ban was still fresh, but my reaction when Kara reached out was, this feels like old news. I was born and raised in Eugene, Oregon, Nike's birthplace, and the self-proclaimed track and field capital of the world. Nike runners had godlike status in my home state. For years, on regular visits back, gossip about whether Alberto, Galen, Kara, and other Oregon Project runners were doping was nearly constant, not only on the lips of my sports-obsessed family, but at local coffee shops and bars. Everyone wanted to know if Alberto and his runners only pushed the edges of doping rules or crossed them. More recently, people questioned how Kara's claim could be true, that some people on the tight-knit Oregon Project team could be dirty and others clean. My feeling was that the sport was tarnished and had never been squeaky clean in the first place. One idol after the next had been accused to have been cheating over the years, from Marianne Jones to Justin Gatlin to countless Russian track and field athletes. And the motivations were clear. Jones has admitted to taking performance-enhancing drugs. Gatlin, who had tested positive for banned substances twice and was served bans in 2001 and 2006, had denied that he doped until 2017, when he apologized for, quote, any wrongdoings or black eyes I've brought onto the sport, according to Sports Illustrated. If you could take something to become richer, stronger, and more famous, and knew you were unlikely to get caught, would you do it? What if you knew that many of your competitors were doing it already? Factor in that you have a very limited window to earn the income you'll be living off of for a lifetime, and the knowledge that with a single injury, your career could be over. This didn't make doping right, but I felt I understood the very real and potent incentives to cheat. More to the point, I wondered how much the question of who did and didn't cross the lines even mattered. By 2019, my focus had shifted away from covering sports in a traditional sense. I had just released an audio series about Larry Nassar and the institutional failures and cover-ups that had allowed him to abuse young gymnasts for decades. Once I started reporting on serial pedophiles and systemic corruption, I found it hard to care as much about athletes trying to shave a few seconds off their finish times with some shady supplements. I was asking questions about complicity, enablement, and trauma. I was interested in the resilience and bravery of the young women who spoke out, brought their abuser to justice, exposed troubled institutions, and changed the way America thinks and talks about survivorship. So, as I got ready for what I was certain would be a quick call with Kara, expecting to hear about steroids and supplements, testosterone creams, and intravenous infusions, I was already brainstorming a polite response. The Nike Oregon Project story had been well covered. Alberta was banned. Life moved on. Then she started talking, and everything changed. I couldn't type fast enough. Running and doping were a part of the story, but there was so much more. Things that she had never spoken about, except to a few of her closest family members and to the investigators at the myriad sports and law enforcement agencies pursuing Salazar's case. The dynamics from inside the Nike headquarters were beyond what I had ever imagined. As with the Nassar scandal, Kara's story was about abuse, both subtle and overt, the culture in which it transpired, a chain of command that allowed it to proliferate, and the risks faced by those who spoke out. Kara, the runner who had appeared on billboards and in glossy magazine spreads for nearly a decade, depicted by Nike as the perky Olympian mom from the Midwest, had lived a double life that reminded me of John le Carré thrillers, rife with secrets, lies, and threats. Her story was exactly the sort I was interested in, and that I wanted to help tell. As we kept talking, conversations punctuated by barking dogs, walks to school, caretaking for older relatives, the drumbeats of our respective lives, we established two basic ground rules. One, no questions were off limits. Two, Kara would provide documents, photographs, logbooks, medical records, texts, emails, arbitration transcripts, contracts, and access to her contacts, including her family members and people in the running world, so I could verify her claims. She delivered on all counts. Kara's story is one that only a very small handful of people have ever heard before. It contains details about sexual abuse and doping, exploitation of power and corporate corruption, alcoholism and disordered eating. In the PDF, you'll find resources to learn more about these topics and gain assistance if you or someone you know needs help. To write this book, I had to ask Kara to relive some of the most painful moments of her life. After years of holding herself back from looking too closely into what had happened, for reasons of self-protection, among others, she was opening up all of the doors and windows. There were moments in our conversations where it almost felt like she was stepping back into memory, as if awakening from a dream, re-entering the experiences as she understood them at the time. One of my favorite memoirs is The Night of the Gun, by my late friend and mentor, David Carr, which wasn't just about the facts of David's addiction, but how his relationship to reality had changed over time. Kara's book is similar in that it's the story of someone coming to terms with inconvenient truths that she struggled for years to compartmentalize and put away. It's about exposing the facts, and also how her relationship to them has and continues to evolve. It is her love story with running, the sport to which she has devoted her life. It is the type of memoir she and I wish that we had read in the past and want to see more of on bookstore shelves now. And it's all true. Inspired by David's application of journalistic rigor to the memoir genre, I reviewed thousands of pages of documents. Kara subjected herself to hundreds of hours of interviews over a four-year period, and dozens of other sources were interviewed. I retraced Kara's steps in Colorado, Oregon, Los Angeles, Boston, and New York. I built a 40-page timeline of Kara's story. My notes encompass more than 550 pages in several notebooks. I suspect that many people, women in particular, will find pieces of Kara's story all too relatable. I know that I did. The sports media world shares some uncomfortable parallels with the companies like Nike that sponsor the athletes it covers. In 2021, 79% of sports editors were white men. When I asked for a raise at the New York Times, a masthead editor met me with rolled eyes and said, "I'm tired of women coming in here for their lean-in moment." I had my story ideas reassigned to men on the sports desk without my permission, and once had a reporter respond to my inquiries about taking an overseas post with questions about my fertility. But, like Kara, at earlier points in her life, I largely stayed quiet about my frustrations, seeing it as a tax I had to pay to do what I loved, putting everything that I could into the page and blowing off steam on the running trail. Nike, unlike many S&P 100 companies, doesn't release official data about its demographic makeup, but has faced outcries from investors and employees about its lack of diversity. Though they've made splashy announcements about how they're increasing representation, Nike's board of directors recommended that shareholders vote down a proposal to publish more detailed reports about diversity and inclusion measures in 2021. A 2018 memo that leaked also quoted Monique Matheson, an executive vice president of global human resources at Nike, saying that Nike had, quote, failed to gain traction in hiring and promoting more women and people of color. At its core, this book is about power. Historically, stories like Kara's get swept under the rug. And that seems to be precisely what Nike attempted to do. The company has felt so threatened by Kara's claims against Alberto that it has allegedly spent millions of dollars to fight them. Nike and many of the powers in the sports world don't want you to hear it, but you need to know this story. If you've ever bought a shirt or a pair of shoes with a swoosh, you need to know this story. If you've ever tuned in to watch an Olympic final, a World Series, a Super Bowl, or any other professional sporting event, you need to know this story. Kara and I have spent 4 years of our lives trying to make that happen. Along the way, I've often found myself wondering, why did Kara speak out? Why did she keep going in the face of death threats and lawsuits? How does a person summon the courage to take on an abuser, a company, an industry, with such dismal odds of winning any sort of justice? Thanks to Kara, I now know the answer. Mary Plon, Los Angeles, June 2022.
Author's note. In legal documents and proceedings, Nike's lawyers have denied claims surrounding alleged abuse and doping at the Nike Oregon Project. In 2015, Nike said it conducted an internal investigation into Alberto Salazar and Galen Rupp and found nothing. In August 2021, they removed Alberto's name from a building on their Beaverton campus. This change follows the Safe Sport decision to permanently ban Alberto from coaching, a Nike spokeswoman said in a statement to employees, which was obtained by the Willamette Week. The nature of the allegations and the finding of a lifetime ban make it appropriate to change the name of the building. Alberto has also denied doping and abuse claims, both in legal proceedings and in a lengthy blog post. He said he followed USADA and WADA protocols and that he never forced athletes to take prescriptions illegally. He wrote, "Let the haters hate. We're going to keep winning through hard work, dedication, and fair play." Galen and Mo Farah, too, have denied all allegations that they took any banned substances or otherwise violated doping protocols or any NCAA rules. Neither the NCAA nor USADA has served either of them a violation or reported a positive test result. Preface. I was 6 years old when my grandpa, Calvin Hayworth, took me to my first running race. The one-mile jaunt was a part of the 1984 Hermantown Festival, an annual celebration that took place near our home in Duluth, Minnesota. The festival was like countless others that take place across the country in the summer. Kids running around, parents chasing them, the smell of hamburgers and hot dogs in the air, local businesses handing out keychains and brochures, some faces you knew, some that you didn't. It also included a foot race open to both kids and adults. Papa, as my two sisters and I called him, held my hand at the starting line. I wiggled among the cluster of arms and legs, dancing between excitement and fear.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.